grade material. And it was mined also in Holland Baker, Jarvis, and other islands in the Pacific Ocean in the 1800s. And then in the Palau, and it was mined during the 1900s. I've looked at some of those. So basically, these are the types of phosphate deposits. Here in the blue is the seamount phosphates we just talked about. The green ones are all insular and lagoonal phosphates into the Indian Ocean. There's also some in the Caribbean. And then you have plateau phosphates. You have Chatham Rise down here off of New Zealand. There is a lease. I'll point out that lease in my next talk. There's a lease for mining phosphates down in Chatham Rise off of New Zealand. There have been several leases off of Africa, was not shown here, also for the mining of phosphates. The big major deposits on land, a few of them are shown here, this one in Western North America and other ones. I headed a project to study those guys, and they're really running out of phosphate. We're gonna have to turn to the marine environment. There's a couple of large phosphate deposits in Northern Africa and in the Middle East, one in Saudi Arabia, for example. That's still fairly new and has a lot of reserves, but not enough to supply the world. There's some big ones off here as well. This is just an area photograph of Nauru, and it's an island about 6 by 4.7 kilometers. And the phosphate covered the entire interior part, and it was it formed between dolomite pinnacles, which is a carbonate. It formed from guano from bird droppings and that kind of thing through chemical leaching. And it was a large producer of phosphate for many, many years and made Nauru a very rich nation at one time. There's a third type of phosphate in the deep ocean, not so interesting to the Southwest Pacific, but certainly interesting to the East Pacific because the dominant ones are off of Peru and Chile. And these are very, very large deposits, and these are the types that are occurring off of West Africa also that may be mined as well. And those occur in very specific places. The water has no oxygen in it in this particular area, and so there's no biota living on the seafloor. But the phosphate likes to form just above that area where there's a little bit of oxygen, and just below where there's a little bit of oxygen. So exploration for these deposits is fairly easy in these environments. Thank you.
Thanks, Jim. Time for a couple of quick questions for Jim. There'll be more time for discussion at the end, but if anybody's got a couple of questions now, we can take them.
So really good, clear, I guess.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, Jim. Quick question, the black smoke and the white smoke, as you mentioned, the temperature difference, is that the cause of the color difference in the smoke, or is it something else?
The difference is, the white smoker has produced more sulfates, and the black smoker is sulfides, and it's usually a temperature difference. The white smokers are low temperature, but that depends on what the temperature is going to be, depends on the water depth. So that's going to vary somewhat depending on water depth as well. So that's the basic difference.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, potentially a naive question, but I noticed from your presentation that the Pacific seems to be an area very rich in many of these kind of deposits compared to, say, the Atlantic or other areas. Is that a reasonable conclusion, or is there kind of numbers on the importance of the Pacific compared to other areas of the world ocean?
Well, that's a very good observation, and it's quite true. The Pacific Ocean, of course, is as big as all the land area of the globe, of the world, so it is a very large ocean compared to the others. But the Atlantic Ocean and the Indian Ocean are dominated by spreading center ridges, and so there's hydrothermal activity that dilute the crust that form in those areas. So the crusts are not as rich in metals as they are in the Pacific Ocean. And the ocean floor is not as old. But there are some areas around the eastern margin and around the western margin of the Atlantic and in the center of the Indian Ocean that have quite thick and rich crusts. And some of the highest thorium contents in crusts occur in the Indian Ocean, and some of the highest highest rare earth element contents occur in the Indian Ocean and the Atlantic Ocean. And this may be very important. I hadn't planned on talking about thorium, but the world is probably going to move towards thorium nuclear power because it doesn't have the waste products like uranium does, and it's more abundant, and you don't produce plutonium to make nuclear weapons with. And I think that the world's going to go to thorium nuclear power. It's a really important issue. And crusts do have high thorium in the Atlantic and Indian Ocean. So your observation is exactly right.
Okay, thank you very much, and thanks again, Jim. Next speaker is going to be Ray Binns. I think there's a little bit of technical stuff that needs to go on before Ray speaks. So while he's doing that, let me just give a couple of other announcements. You'll notice that the presentations are all being videotaped. We were hoping to do a webcast of the workshop, but that's not possible because of bandwidth issues, but we are going to upload the videos onto the ISA website as soon as we can process them. We also have a live Twitter feed on the ISA website. The hashtag for that, I'm told, is @ISAHQ. So if any of you indulge in tweeting or twittering or whatever it's called, then please go ahead and tell your friends, and we are also going to monitor that, and people can ask questions and have input into the debate as we go along. Okay, so the next speaker is Ray Binns, who's going to give us more detail on seafloor massive sulfide potential in the Asia-Pacific.
Thank you. This is a topic that I was asked to speak about, but Jim Hyan has already given my talk. Spent quite a bit of time on seafloor massive sulfides, a term that's become popular in recent years, but I actually prefer the term polymetallic sulfides, which is what ISA used in the past, because many of these seafloor deposits aren't actually massive sulfides according to geological definitions. Now, what I propose to do is describe what they are, how they're formed, where they occur geologically, where they occur politically in this Asia-Pacific region. And if I have time at the end, I'll just make a few comments from a geologist's perspective on the environmental side. So, seafloor massive sulfides are bodies of metallic mineral sulfides that occur on the seafloor at submarine volcanic hot springs on the deep sea floor. Deep sea floor mean that pressures are quite high and therefore water doesn't boil up at quite high temperatures. So the fluids involved can be very aggressive and carry significant metalliferous loads. When these fluids coming up through the crust meet cold seawater at and near the seabed, then they immediately precipitate out their mineral load as they cool down to virtually 0 degrees centigrade and build up these crazy structures which have traditionally been called chimneys. So you can see there that a lot of them are rather gothic looking chimneys, if anything. But the process is inefficient and quite a lot of mineral particles get carried up into the seawater column, and indeed that becomes a very efficient way of finding them. You just look for that turbid water in the seawater column. The deposits occur in two main tectonic environments. The white stars there reflect the seafloor spreading ridges in terms of plate tectonics. That's where new crust is being formed and the plates are spreading apart, according to those white arrows there. In the case of the Pacific, East Pacific seafloor spreading zone, they travel across the Pacific, the crust travels across and disappears then under Australia and Asia in the area of those red stars, which are seafloor massive sulfide deposits in what are called subduction zones or convergent plate margins. There are a couple of other types of sulfide deposit known in the oceans. The green star in the mid-Atlantic is a rather unusual case where the deep mantle of the Earth, ultramafic rocks, have been brought to the surface by pretty strange tectonic forces, and there are some very copper-rich deposits associated with them, and a
Ritz is the famous Ritz Eusis, which were discovered long before these SMS deposits. A little bit of history here. In 1965, it was recognized there were metalliferous or metal enrichments in the sediments at the East Pacific Rise, and that led to a belief that there must somewhere be a source. And because people have been studying ancient ore deposits, they said, well, these are going to be volcanic hot spring type sources. And the first sulfides weren't discovered until 1977. And a few years after that, 79, the first active black smokers were found in the East Pacific Rise. And the photographs there is the so-called National Geographic chimney. It was published almost immediately after the discovery in National Geographic. 1986, the first deposits were found in the photograph. They weren't actually dredged until a few years later. In the main space in a subduction setting, the red stars of the previous slide. And then a commercial activity was attracted to these when in the Manus Basin, as a result of an industry support project in CSIRO, we found very high copper gold deposits, and that attracted commercial attention and led to the first commercial cruise in 1985. As we'll probably hear later from Sam Smith, next year, hopefully the first mine will be operating. A few photographs of young chimneys, one very young one there, but on the lower left, that black structure there is a chimney that grew 60 centimetres in 2 days over a drill hole at the Solwara 1 deposit of Nautilus Minerals. While drilling, the drill hole turned into a black smoker and it grew this chimney. Being all sulfide, it's quite black, but in nature, the chimneys very quickly through diffuse venting of moderate temperature fluids build up a coating of microbial mat, white or brown, just a bit of iron mixed up with it, and that becomes the source for this extraordinary vent type fauna that builds up, and which will no doubt be the subject of a lot of discussion later in this meeting. So the point to make here is that individual chimneys can be very short-lived, maybe just a few years. We've seen sites where we've had one cruise and seen absolutely nothing, come back 5 years later, and there's quite an active field operating. As well as these young environments, which most of the stars, the red stars and white stars of that earlier map, were discovered by scientific research teams using the plumes, so they were active fields. But there are old chimney fields that still survive. Here's some examples of old chimneys that got no fauna associated with them, or a few barnacles perhaps. And these deposits probably become weathered. There's a chimney that's been knocked down here on the lower right, which is composed largely of iron oxide now. And very little work's been done on these, probably most of the copper and zinc content in them has been dissolved out and disappeared off into the seawater column, whereas things like arsenic and maybe gold and so on could be preserved in them. So although in the early days of SMS exploration, people said, well, we should look for the inactive fields, we're not going to have any environmental problems. The chances are that in these fields, most of the valuable elements will no longer exist. So then there's something, as I say, which has not received a lot of study. Why do we consider mining SMS as well? There are deposits known now quite a few of them, which are extraordinarily rich compared to land-based mineral deposits. In Chile, they're mining at 0.3-0.4% copper, and these things are going tens of percent of copper. In Kalgoorlie, they're mining a couple of parts of a million gold, and here we've got 50 or so parts of a million. In this is a cross-section of a very copper-rich chimney from the Solwara 1 site. And that chimney would have looked like the one on the right there, a very rather spiky, with many, many little orifices smoking away there. You can see the grades there, and the actual sort of value of metal in situ is $5,800 a tonne, or it was a couple of weeks ago. Prices have gone down now, of course. Or if you prefer zinc in cubic metres, you've got $19,000. And these deposits can probably be brought to the surface for relatively low cost, perhaps $150-$200 a tonne, some of the estimates that people make. So it's potentially a lot of profit to be made in those types of deposits. But what makes it a deposit? The chimneys alone, and from known chimney fields that have been mapped around the world, there's probably not sufficient size, sufficient volume to justify a mining operation. What's required is for significant mineralisation to occur just below the seabed surface, which is amenable for mining. And chimneys typically sit up on mounds of old chimneys that have fallen over. Here's an example on the left there. And underneath those, where some of these sites have been drilled, and up to date, there's only a few sites around the world which have been drilled, we do find massive sulfides again, which are more like the massive sulfides that you find on land, more crystallised and coarser grained, and can be quite rich. We see an example in the top right there. And underneath those, as in land-based massive sulfide deposits, we see a sort of stockwork type deposit settings and disseminated mineralisation, generally in an altered volcanic host. This is a cartoon of the cross-section through Norbis and Solwara 1 prospect, and there we see the chimneys poking up at the top. Indicated a whole lot of fallen chimneys. In this case, it's slightly different to the previous one, the Roman ruins site, in that nearby there was a very active explosive volcanic eruption, and there was a layer of what you might call submarine tephra or volcanoclastic sediment has been deposited on the surface. And that's got mixed up with chimneys, and it also becomes mineralised itself and lithified. And below that, we have two different kinds of massive sulfide. One is semi-massive in that it has quite a lot of barite and non-sulfide material in it, but it's very rich. And below that, massive pyrite-rich sulfides are still constitute ore grade. So unless you have that submarine development of massive sulfides, and that of course requires expensive drilling, seafloor drilling to establish the fact, it's unlikely that you have enough material to develop an ore deposit, a mineable ore deposit. One of the characteristics of these SMS deposits is that they tend to occur in clusters. Here's a map of the Manus Field and the Manus Basin. The black fields are chimney fields. The ones up on the crest of the ridge were discovered by research teams who were restricted to working on the ridges because we didn't have the equipment to work on steep slopes. But the Nautilus company has used the ROVs to explore the steep slopes and has found a number of other deposits. And rather than give them nice names like Satanic Mills and Roman Ruins and so on, which the researchers do, they call them all Solwara. You can see Solwara 7 and 8 and so on. Solwara meaning salt water. And on an even more regional scale, we get clusters of SMS fields. So that last site was a field rather than just a single group of chimneys. And here we have many fields scattered across the Manus Basin and northeastern part of Bismarck Sea, discovered primarily by Nautilus. Just reminding you now again of these two contrasted tectonic settings. The stars in the subduction zones, the white stars on the seafloor screen, which is obviously in the Asia Pacific region, is this, the pink stars that are of interest. But let's look at the genesis of deposits in those two environments, starting off with the ocean ridge spreading centres. This is where we have new crust being
formed at spreading
axes.
Volcanic activity, which arises from the fact that the plate's been spread apart, has released pressure down here in the Earth's mantle, perhaps 150 kilometres deep, and melting takes place, and that creates the new crust, which is moved away, and it travels in a sort of a conveyor belt fashion across the ocean. The next slide deals with this little part up here. Jim showed a version of this here. Here's the magma body. It operates as a heat engine. It doesn't contribute any fluid to the sulfide system up here because it's a relatively dry magma typically in the mid-ocean spreading zones. Because it's hot, it drives this circulation cell where seawater is sucked in, reacts with the rocks, it travels through, particularly in this higher temperature zone around the magma body, becomes more acidic, it becomes reduced, and it leaches metals out of the rocks that travel through, which then, because it proceeds up, becomes buoyant, moved up to the crest of the spreading ridge, and immediately mixes with seawater and deposits its metal there. The deposits formed in that environment tend to be dominated by iron sulfide, that being one of the dominant elements of the rocks that's passed through. And typically, they do not have viable grades of valuable metals. So, this diagram is a bit more complicated than ideally it should be. It's a classic story, I didn't have time to make a simple one. So I copied someone else's. But this is the sketch of the subduction zone, where oceanic crust here has been either sucked down or forced down, or it's rolling down in return accord. Over here is the hanging wall, and the oceanic crust carries a lot of water down, which fluxes melting in the mantle here, and so we get our volcanism in what's called the volcanic arc, the island arcs. You get behind the island arc, the zone where there is some extension, and that's because of what's happening here, basically. You suck down so it cracks and opens up. And some of this magnetism happens there as well. And one of the features of this, and this is great for the Asia Pacific region, is that the magnets that form in this environment, by contrast with the mid-ocean environment, are relatively rich in water. And this allows them then to release fluids carrying a lot of metal, what happens up on the top of that there, big body of magma here. So as well as some seawater being sucked into the system, as in the ocean ridge example, we have a lot of fluids exsolved from the magma body as it crystallizes, and they get mixed together. And so the sulfides form up here have a lot of the metals derived from the magma, particularly copper and gold, which is what makes the deposits viable. I should just mention that in the so-called back arc spreading ridges, we get many examples of the seafloor spreading axis. So in the Manus Basin, which is this basin here behind the New Britain volcanic bar is the trench. Because of the oblique movement between the Pacific and Australian plates, we get a sort of stretching, and that can be accommodated either as a series of rifts, and volcanic activity there is traditional island arc type volcanic activity, even though the arc is actually down here. So there is a
somewhat complicated tectonic reason for that, which I can't go into. But also, there are places where that stretching is being accommodated by a little spreading ridge, and we get deposits here, which are somewhat similar to the mid-ocean spreading ridges, but because they're in a generally in a subduction environment, they too can be richer in copper and gold. So, where do they occur? It's in this left-hand slide here, recently published by Mark Hannington and Co. Show the red dots are the known sulphide deposits of the Western Pacific, and the yellow are the ones that are suspected, where there are indications that they occur. And the pale blue areas are the exclusive economic zones of the various island nations and the continents and so on. And obviously, you can see from this that the distribution of these deposits corresponds very closely with the so-called Pacific Ring of Fire and the volcanoes that stretch down this other subduction zone system, which is related to a more complicated movement of the Asia plate against the Indian-Australian plate here. Almost effectively a one-to-one correspondence between the island or the active volcanoes that erupt above the seawater and the distribution of these deposits in the submarine environment. Even more spectacular, perhaps, is the correlation between the distribution of those deposits and the earthquake belts. The different colours of the earthquakes there indicate the depths from which they arose, and it gives you an idea of the way that the subduction zone dips, for example. Here in the Tonga region, sloping this way, so the Pacific plate is dipping under the Australian plate. Now, because of those two correlations, we can say with a considerable degree of confidence that there's not going to be any of these SMH deposits rich in copper and gold in the area that's under the jurisdiction of the National Seabed Authority. There's hardly any gaps through here. A couple of little small ones we'll point them out later, which don't belong to some island nation. That's because inevitably there's going to be a volcano that erupts and forms a little island that gets populated. So I'm going to use those diagrams to take you on a little tour quickly down through the Western Pacific, starting up north of Japan. Japan enjoys two major subduction zones converging here, the Izu Bonin Arc and the Okinawa Trough, or whatever Ryukyu Trench system. And has seafloor massive sulphide deposits in both of those settings. This is the boundary between Japan and the North Marianas Guam area. We'll deal with that next. Here's an enlargement of that region there. The deposits tend, in this case, are on seamounts which form the volcanic arc. You can see that there's a lot of submarine and some emergent volcanoes along that zone there. The back arc, or the rifting, which typically is quite a distance away from the arc, is here, very close to it, in fact. So some of these seafloor massive sulphide sites are in the, on the arc, and some are, could be, you could say, are in the back arc. But, this is one of the deposits which was described by the Japanese quite early in the